Blessed are the cheesemakers, and welcome everyone to Silver Screen Slam, where we praise those wonderful moving pictures we've all worshipped over the past century. I'm your host, Jake, that is called Jake, ready to carry you through the respected features that have graced the silver screen. So come join me each episode as we explore movies of the past and present and discuss aspects about them that we exalt, aspects that we torture, and aspects at which we let our loyal viewers hurl their judgmental stones. After each episode, we will ask you to voice your own opinion about upcoming movies we follow via our social media outlets at the bottom of your screen. With that being said, Jehovah. During each episode, we'll discuss a movie that we feel warrants considerable devotion for bringing many positive artistic elements to the screen. This may be a new release, a not-so-new release, or even one of the classics. In our previous episode, we explored 2014's Interstellar, declaring it a near incomparable visual and auditory sensation, albeit lacking some in the character development department. In this episode, we'll seek out a story about a man living in the wrong place at the wrong time, the 1979 comedic tale Life of Brian. But before we thift through the specific aspects of such a silver screen sensation, let's first talk some extras. Life of Brian certainly raised a few eyebrows upon its initial theatrical release, and this gets us thinking about one word, censorship. Ooh, what a scary word. And in some cases, it can be the demise of a film's initial box office success. Take a film like 1997's Titanic. For over 10 years, Titanic was the highest-grossing movie in the world, raking in nearly $2 billion and eventually surpassing that mark after a second theatrical release sometime later. Titanic was rated PG-13, which allowed for virtually anyone of any age to view it in theaters. But if it had been rated R, it would have lost a huge amount of business, as everyone under the age of 17 would have been required to have an accompanying adult view it with them. This requirement is passed down by the Motion Picture Association of America, or MPAA for short. However, Titanic had a nude scene, a sex scene, use of the F-word, which is an absolutely ridiculous censorship if we can say so, many on-screen deaths and more. Now, this isn't to say that it broke the MPAA rules or anything, but it brings up an interesting point, a point further illustrated by one of my favorite films, the 2006 surrealist whimsical tale The Fall. In The Fall, a young girl in the 1920s is hospitalized after falling off of a ladder while picking oranges in an orange grove. While in the hospital, she meets a man who carries her mind away with fantastical tales that are pushed even further by her own imagination. Little does she know that he's only doing so to trick her into getting pain medicine for him from the hospital's pharmacy in an attempt at suicide. It's a powerful story with an ultimate important message, but it's the absolutely gorgeous visuals in The Fall that are second to none, bringing to the screen all breathtaking on-location shots as the settings for these fantastical tales. Not only that, but...
Get on with it!
Get on with it!
Sure. Sorry. The Fall ended up receiving an MPAA rating of R, despite having almost no cursing or drug and alcohol use, with the exception, of course, of the previously mentioned story element, mild on-screen violence, which when portrayed was done so in a very mitigating, artistic way, and a very vaguely implied sexual scene hidden in a completely different room, with no nudity whatsoever. Sure, there are some scary scenes, but an R rating takes it a little too far. Even director Tarsem Singh couldn't figure out why his film had been given such an unwelcome restriction. So what's our point? I'm glad I asked. Once again, movie ratings can be very important for filmmakers, as the monetary effect they often have on a feature can determine how likely future producers are willing to invest in the filmmaker's artistry. Therefore, either we should look into a better rating system than something as flimsy as the MPAA, or we should all take a moment to look a little deeper into the motion pictures we're considering viewing, as their strict ratings may not be as justified as we initially believe. Or maybe we should all just move to TV, where a show can slap a simple TV MA rating on itself and still enjoy huge success with a scene where a brother has sexual relations with his sister under their son's deceased body. God! And with that, we bring you to our featured flick of the episode, the 1979 story of a man who's not the Messiah, Monty Python's Life of Brian. Life of Brian was directed by Terry Jones and featured the writing and acting talents of Jones and the other five Pythons, Graham Chapman, John Cleese, Terry Gilliam, Eric Idle, and my personal favorite, Michael Palin. The story is set in Judea during the time of Jesus of Nazareth and is about a man named Brian Cohen, played by Graham Chapman, born on the same day as and in the stable directly next to Jesus himself. Brian is initially mistaken for the Christian Messiah at the time of his birth, and the humorous confusion only persists further from there. Let's take a quick look at a clip from the film.
Wise men.
What?
We are three wise men.
Well, what are you doing creeping around a cowshed at 2 o'clock in the morning? That doesn't sound very wise to me.
We are astrologers. We have come from the east.
Is this some kind of joke?
We wish to praise the infant.
We must pay homage to him.
Homage? You're all drunk. It's disgusting. Out! Come on, out!
No.
Bursting me here with tales about oriental fortune tellers. Come on, out!
No, no, we must see him.
Go and praise someone else's brat. Go on!
We were led by a star.
Led by a bottle of all light? Go on, out!
Well, we must see him. We have brought presents.
Out!
Gold, frankincense, myrrh.
Well, why didn't you say he's over there? Sorry the place is a bit of a mess. If you drop in by again, do pop in. And thanks a lot for the gold and frankincense. But don't worry too much about the myrrh next time, all right? Thank you. Goodbye. Oh, weren't they nice?
Out of their bloody minds, but still.
Look at that. Here, that's mine. Hey, you gave me that.
Now, as Brian grows older, he begins to resent the ongoing Roman occupation of Judea and eventually falls in love with a young, rebellious woman named Judith, played by Sue Jones-Davies. But it's when Brian joins Judith's separatist movement, who call themselves the Judean People's Front... the People's Front of Judea, that he gets caught in a series of events that leads nearly everyone to mistake him for their savior. And no matter how hard Brian resists this role, their refusal to listen to him, coupled with the JPF's botched subversion plans, attract the attention of the Roman authorities, leading to eventual threats of Brian's crucifixion. The movie was the third of five full-length feature films from the comedy troupe, all of which followed a highly successful TV series as well. So what has this movie ever done for us? Well, it's brought a level of satire I've never seen in any other film. Life of Brian is easily my favorite comedy of all time, and when it debuted in 1979, it set the bar higher than ever for intelligent, fearless humor. And for a topic like this, there's no one out there who could have pulled it off quite like the Pythons. I mean, you've got the character of Brian, an average person like so many of us who lives each day simply trying to figure out his own problems and the meaning of life. But it's the mentality of the society around Brian that's so special. With this society, the Pythons bring to light the common misconceptions many of us have about such an early time period. It's a clear representation of the more naive mindset that its people shared. How easy it could have been to convince someone of a supernatural feat, even if such a feat were denied again and again. That extreme willingness to believe that even the simplest of strange events might be magically affected by an almighty higher power. And not just that, there are so many hilarious observations incorporated into this setting as well, such as Jesus putting someone out of a begging trade by curing his leprosy, and a centurion guard giving someone defacing a Roman wall a crash course in proper Latin grammar. Every single scene is bursting with great Python humor like this. But also expressed throughout the film are perceptions of death that tend to be different from our own today. In Brian's day, crucifixion was quite a common death penalty for many crimes, as it was intended to dissuade those around the sentenced individual from committing the same illegal act. Now, this all sounds very dark, but it's exactly why the Pythons are the perfect artists to take on such a difficult topic. as their eccentric style of comedy and silly characters and situations lighten the message of the film in a way that allows the audience to better appreciate it in the end. All perfect qualities to us, yes, but there's no pleasing some people, as there have been those over the years who have looked down on Life of Brian, taking it as a work of blasphemy or something to that effect. Some have stated that this movie pokes fun at Jesus and his own personal messages. Others have said that it mocks the Christian religion altogether. However, I like to think that the film's message is instead one of the human condition. I like to think that it's trying to tell us to think for ourselves rather than unquestioningly obey every command around us. The story enlightens us by presenting many realistic scenarios, albeit laced with plenty of absurd humor.
Shall lose his friend's hammer, and the young shall not know where lieth the things possessed by their fathers, that their fathers put there only just the night before, about 8 o'clock.
That reflect the plethora of beliefs in our own society. It never once directly attacks any religion or spiritual stance at all. And as for Jesus, aside from the quick glimpse of his birth, the only time he's ever shown in this movie is during an early scene of his famous Sermon on the Mount, which is presented as accurately and honestly as could be, and is displayed mostly as a placing mechanism for the film's chronology and location, as well as to introduce Brian and his situation at hand. Also, it's a great excuse to throw in this line.
Oh, it's the meek! Blessed are the meek! Oh, that's nice, isn't it? I'm glad they're getting something, because they had a hell of a time.
So sure, we've had our one or two things to say about this film, but what does our public think? And since our last episode, we once again had another comment from Twitter user AnthonyC11749. And it reads, 15, negative 5, 7, 2, 15, 10, 15, 15, negative 4, negative 6, negative 1, 19, 6, 12, negative 7, 3. Well, that explains a lot. And a Capricorn, too. Life of Brian has made quite a name for itself over the years with its controversial subject matter and classic Monty Python comedic style. So we had to ask ourselves what there could be to recommend to our loyal viewers who appreciate such a film. And we feel the best choice is the 1949 Coronet instructional film How to Be Well-Groomed. How to Be Well-Groomed follows siblings Don and Sue as they take us on a powerful journey through their weekly hygiene rituals and discover more about themselves in the process. Each day is a new adventure, with Don searching to find what to wear to school here and Sue making herself up for her night out there. The excitement never ends, nor do the profound messages. After all, it really doesn't matter just what hairstyle you use, as long as it looks right on you. This revolutionary film shares with Life of Brian the struggles one faces during youth, namely those of the always judging eyes of our peers and our constant search for independence in the chaotic world of growing up. The way Don presses down with such careful strength as he irons his clothes is echoed in how Brian presses through the trials and tribulations of local Roman oppression. The way Sue avoids wearing red nail polish in order to draw attention away from her stubby hands mirrors Brian's avoidance of his perceived messianic role by drawing attention away from himself and toward others around him. The two films are almost identical in their messages, right down to the portrayal of each of the film's mothers and their own concerns over their beautiful appearances. Well, we hope you've enjoyed this episode of Silver Screen Slam. Join us soon for our final episode of the season, when we'll be checking out the 2002 post-apocalyptic horror masterpiece, 28 Days Later, directed by Danny Boyle and starring Cillian Murphy and Naomi Harris. If you have anything you'd like to voice about next episode's film, or if you enjoy the show in general, feel free to swarm by our social media outlets at the bottom of your screen. Thanks for tuning in. I'm Jake Brown. And now for something completely different. There you go. Silver Screen Slam. Little does she know that he's only doing so to trick her into getting pain medicine from him for him, not from him. Don't say it like that, Jake, you silly goose. Monty Python comedic style. So we good line. Good line, Jake. Representation of the more naive mindset that it ever shown follows siblings Dawn and Sue as they take us on a powerful